Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Lady Deborah Radio Show. I'm your host, Lady Deborah, and my co-host, Carlton Carter. He will be here momentarily, but I just want to let you know we do have a couple of guest hosts who will be participating with us on the show today. We have author and renowned a philanthropist, I would say, as well, and computer lady. We have here Miss Terry Maxwell. Okay, Terry is an author, and she has a lot of information as it relates to domestic violence. Today, our theme will be on domestic violence, and the main thing will be we'll be talking about how we handle crisis in our life. So with that being said, we'll talk about the biblical word. We'll talk about real talk and real information in reference to what's going on in the world today. And we'll also digress into our spotlight corner. And that's where we'll have some guests here today that will be telling us a little bit about what's going on with them as it relates to their platform, because we'll have Kendall Wade coming in. He'll be joining us around 3 o'clock. He is running for sheriff for Prince George's County. Yay! Okay. And then we also have, as I mentioned, Terry, our author here, standing in for us today. And then we also may have a call-in from Kathy McKnight. And she works with a nonprofit organization that helps people who are victims of domestic violence and try to share the word about, you know, how important it is to be of a support to people who are suffering or had the hands of domestic violence in their life. So we want to make sure that we support her if she calls in as well. And then the last segment, or the last two segments, is our cooking segment. The cooking segment is the one that Carlton loves to get on me about. But today is my birthday, so hopefully he'll give me a little slack today. But with that being said, we're going to talk about the paleo diet, okay? And we're going to talk about summer foods, because sometimes during the summer months, we don't want to eat as heavy, okay? And so sometimes we change our diets to mirror what is going on in the summer. So a lot of people are eating the fruits more so than they would normally be eating some other things, okay? And then the last segment is the mind, body, and the soul segment. In that segment, we will be talking about how we handle crisis, what types of crisis that they are in our lives that impact us. And sometimes there's a physical, you know, attribute to that as well that causes us to have some other things going on with our body. So we're going to talk about that a little bit as well. And again, as I said, today is my birthday. So yay. Okay. Happy birthday to me.
Yay.
So we have a couple of special treats that we're going to have, because Terry's going to read a little bit from a book. And so those of you who would like to call in, the number is 240-455-5934. She's going to read a book that you'll be able to have an opportunity to try to win. So again, the number to call in is 240-455-5934. If you'd like to tune in, you can tune in live to us at elifemedia.net. Once again, you can tune in live, and that's online at elifemedia.net. So our host, like I said, Carlton Carter, he has just got here. So we're going to take a quick commercial break. And so when we come back, we will start with our Real Talk segment and let you know what's going on locally, nationally, and globally in the world today. So we'll be right back.
It's your birthday. Many, many, many more. Oh, today is a special day, one you never had before. I'll send you flowers by the hour, candy and perfume. I'm gonna shower you, precious baby, birthday baby, tonight. Today is your birthday. I wish you many, many, many more. Oh, today is a special day, one you never had before. I'll send you flowers by the hour with candy and perfume. I'm gonna shower you, pretty baby, baby, tonight.
thanks for staying tuned to the Lady Deborah Radio Show. Today, we're going to get right into the real talk and find out what's going on locally, nationally, and globally. So one of the things that I noticed, and it's on a sad note, you know, with deep, you know, and heavy hearts, is that the anchor man, Mr. Jim Vance, died recently. And so he had been around for over 40 years, you know, with the television station and sharing the news and all of that. And so it's unfortunate that we lost somebody so good, but at the same token, rest in peace, Mr. Jim Vance. So anybody else want to say anything about some stories or what they know about Jim Vance? Anything, Terry? Okay, well, I'll take the floor on that. I know that he has been doing it because he's been like a part of my life when I jump in and watch TV and see the news. And so I used to remember him. And at one point in time, there was Maureen Bunyan, and then it was J.C. Haywood, and just a host of other people and stuff like that who were doing the news and stuff. And so I know they're playing a big old funeral or what have you. And so I'm sure they'll share that information. I don't have that at my disclosure at this time. But when we know about it, we'll share it or what have you. But again, a heavy loss for the community, and all I can say is that, you know, we keep his family lifted up in prayer. And so the other thing that's going on in the news today is that I just read something about that they're trying to ban the killing of bears and the baby cubs and stuff like that, because in Alaska they have gotten out of control with that. And so we want to make sure that, you know, we stay tuned and follow up on that as well, because, you know, they're using them for meat, unfortunately, you know, and that's a sad thing. And so what happens is that, you know, they're not just stopping just to get the mom, they're getting the babies too. So, you know, that's sad. So they're not even getting a chance to even live before they're getting killed or what have you. So did you have anything y'all wanted to say on that in reference to Alaska and the baby cubs and the bears being killed? Not really.
It's just because they want the food, they don't want the skin.
Yeah, pretty much.
It's
been going on for quite some time, so it's just kind of sad to hear that that's going on. Did you have anything that you want to share that's going on newsworthy on Colton?
Sure, I wanted to comment regarding Jim Vance. So, for those who are new to D.C., he's been on the air for 45 years at one company, and that's News Channel 4, and for 25 consecutive years, they were number one. When you had Doreen Gensler, George Michael for sports, Bob Ryan for weather.
Brenner.
And actually, I think Brenner was Channel 9. Brenner was Channel 9. Okay. So you had George Michael, which is Channel 4.
Mm-hmm.
And you had the weather with Bob Ryan, Doreen Gensler, who's still anchoring at 11.
Wow.
And you had Jim Vance. And from what I was reading, that their ratings were so high, they were number one, that they were, you could take CNN, MSNBC, and Fox and combine them all together, and it still didn't outrate them collectively combined.
Wow.
So people trusted that team in Tangent.
Mm-hmm.
They had the right chemistry and mix. And I remember growing up with them from my childhood to now. So it's going to be strange not to see Jim Vance.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering, as I was looking at the news the last couple of years, what happened to Jim Vance? Did he retire? But to find out that he actually had cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess he wanted to keep that quiet. So it definitely is a loss. Someone wrote that another great monument in D.C. has now been lost.
Oh, that's nice.
And
nice.
So he was a staple of the community. They even said that when Marion Barry got in trouble, the first person he called was Jim Vance. Because Jim Vance suffered from depression, he also suffered from drug addiction, so he had to check into the Betty Ford Clinic. And so he contacted Vance because Vance had publicly been open about his struggles and how he overcame. And so he was looking, he sought Jim Vance because he knew Jim Vance was in the public eye. And how do you deal with something that now has been put out there?
Mm-hmm.
And so Vance gave him counsel and helped him work through that problem. So in many aspects, Jim Vance has been a mentor to many, and he's been a familiar face and a source of comfort for all. So yes, his face is, because I'm very familiar with him, mm-hmm. is going to be missed seeing him. And so, as far as other local news, as you were talking about, Deborah, someone texted me what the superintendent just gave a speech to Annapolis, and it was all about grade inflation. I don't know if you've heard about the grade inflation regarding graduation rates has been inflated. And so the backstory to that is that Maxwell has received his bonus, which was $450,000 a year, plus $1 million signing bonus based on graduation rates.
Wow.
And four school board members said that they have proof and written testimony and documentation saying that the graduation rates have been inflated, and that they were forced, some of the high school principals were forced to change grades in order to inflate the graduation rates. So Hogan has now asked the State Department of Education to launch an investigation, and they are investigating the situation right now. So what Maxwell said was that, and he had a student stand up, which disturbed me, because he had a student stand up and say that there are no grade inflations. And how would a student know if there are grade inflations going on within the district? Why would he do that? And so it's an ongoing thing. It's very disturbing. But also in the article, it talks about how they have many schools that have contaminated drinking water, lead in the drinking water, and that so many things structurally are wrong with the system, but yet we spend more money per student, not per student, but more money is given to Prince George's County per state dollars and per federal money than any other district in the state of Maryland. But yet we have crumbling buildings, we have unsafe drinking water, we had an elementary school that had asbestos in the roof and would not relocate. We have an administration that is so top heavy, there's more executives in his cabinet than at any time ever in Prince George's County history. But yet teachers haven't been given a raise in over 5 years. But yet he is now the highest paid superintendent in America. And you start to wonder where is our priorities?
Yeah.
What has happened to our school system? And as I talked to a homeowners association this past week, they were talking about small businesses, and I said to them, I did some fact finding, and that 30% of the people who own businesses, only 30% of the people who own businesses in Prince George's County live in Prince George's County. Let me say that again. Only 30% of people who own, yes, I did say it right, only 30% of the owners, business owners that own a business in Prince George's County actually live in Prince George's County. 70% live in another county because they say they don't have confidence in the school system. It is not a healthy environment to raise their family. And so the homeowners ask me, why did I make that such an issue? Because if you do not fix the home, if you do not fix the school system, which is killing us, crime goes up, housing values go down, it is not an attractive place to live. Mm-hmm. And just to back up the data, what I'm saying, the Comptroller of Maryland, who has been in office for over a decade now, said there's two things that's holding down Prince George's County. It is the school system and job creation. And so those are the two mechanisms that are holding our system hostage, because we spend so much money, 60% of our total budget goes into the school system, and we have the lowest performing school system, decaying school buildings, frustrated teachers, over 900 teachers put on administrative leave this past year, $10 million spent on substitutes. And once again, and it just goes on and on and on. And I can tell you off the record that I have talked to many principals, because I was a principal in the county, and asked them off the record, does grade inflation occur? And they said yes. They've been told many times to inflate the grades. Now the issue is, it is a reality, but the issue is, can they prove it?
Now that's going to be
so. But I will tell you. I will tell you that many of the principals that I know, current and past, have told me that is a practice.
It's a real thing.
So are they threatened that they will lose their job?
You'll lose their job. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they will lose their job if they will actually come forward. So that's why Hogan's trying to put a whistleblower. Whistleblower protection, because when you have a huge cover-up such as this, you are fearful for your job.
Yes.
Because if you come out and you say it, and you're a current employee, and you say that, yes, you know, my supervisor, maybe not Maxwell himself, but the supervisor told me, hey, your graduation rate is below 80%. You need to do something. I don't care if the students didn't earn it or not. We need to get it to this set number.
So are we talking about middle school or high school?
We're talking about high school. High school graduation rates.
Mm-hmm. Okay, gotcha. Mm-hmm.
So he's been touting that the high school graduation rates have in Prince George's County have been at an all-time high. Well, Terry, I can tell you, but see, when you take something called the PARC exam, is now a statewide test that all counties take. And it's a state test that measures you in English and math. And so there's no escape from the PARC exam because it measures what the students know and don't know. You can make graduation rates 100%, but yet every student in the system can fail the PARC exam because it's controlled by the state and is measured up against the other 23 counties in Maryland. And PG County ranks dead last. So how in the world do you have 85% graduation rates, but you're dead last in academic performance on the test? Your graduation rates should match. If it's at 85%, that means 85% of the students should be passing the test.
And that's outstanding, those numbers, Colton, because they should mirror each other. And that's not what he's saying as a parent. They're like even below what they need to be. But yet you're saying on this end, on a high level, the graduation rate is succeeding and it's successful. And that's just not even right. It's nowhere near right. So I'd like, if anybody like to call in and talk to Colton about that, or just chime in on the radio station here today, you can give us a call at 240, and that's 455-5934. Again, the number to call us is 240-455-5934. One of the other things that was in the news is John McCain, okay, and his recent diagnosis and stuff. And so I hear that, he's just going through, as anybody else would, with something that was just brought to their attention. But he seems to be a trooper, and he seems to be, have a positive outlook on that. Did anybody else hear about him as well?
Well, for the viewers, John McCain was diagnosed with some type of form of brain cancer.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it's above the left or right eye. Someone please correct me.
I'm not sure.
But it's the same type of cancer that Ted Kennedy had.
Right.
And so they're looking at his options, but he's going to press on. So it's a tough situation for John McCain. And I'm not going to speak out any further on it, Deborah, because I don't know anything else, and I only know what's being reported.
Okay. Well, there was also something else that was in the news. We'll keep him up, lift him up in prayer. But there was also something else in the news at a recent rap concert that a number of people got injured. I don't know if you heard about that, Colton, but, when you have a number of people at some of these events and stuff like that, number one is that trying to control people when an incident occurs. For an example, if somebody, gets into a physical altercation or something like that, that can be problematic. For an example, if there is inclement weather like it is right now, it's raining like cats and dogs out there right now, but sometimes that can impact, how people try to get out of the way of harm's way, and sometimes it's pushing and it's thrusting people around. But this one wasn't on either a weather condition or anything like that. It was just something that occurred. But sometimes the lyrics and it's a message in our music and stuff like that, we got to be careful what we're saying to people, because sometimes those subliminal messages, as well as those messages that are not subliminal, can lead to, you know, stir up the, some trouble with, I guess, some of the participants at some of these events. But I'm not saying that is what occurred, but I'm also saying that as I studied to be a psychologist, I know that I focus a lot on messaging and branding, and so sometimes we have to be careful how we put stuff out there and the delivery of it. So I just want to throw that out there as well. So what we'll do now is we'll give people an opportunity to call in if they'd like. Again, the number is 240-455-5934. Again, the number is 240-455-5934. And then I'm just going to digress over here to Terry, because Terry had something she wanted to share in reference to a handout or something that we can give them as a token. So go ahead and start reading that passage for us, and then we'll go ahead and give them the number once you finish so they can call in and see if they can win it.
Wonderful. Well, great to see everybody again. This book is by a woman named Carol Hamblett Adams, and it's called My Beautiful Broken Shell. It's Words of Hope to Refresh the Soul, and this is a book that I give to a lot of my clients, and I just wanted to read this to you, and if you're interested, it's for you, it's free. So here it goes. The Preface. This story began shortly after my husband Steve was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. I was feeling frightened, discouraged, alone. I went to the beach one day and decided to gather a few shells for my collection. The first one I picked up was a broken scallop shell, so I threw it back. But then I picked it up again and saw myself as I was at that moment, broken too, just like the shell. God spoke to me about my brokenness, and I put his words on paper. Over the years, this reflection has helped me and many others get through difficult times. It is my hope that it will help you or someone you love, that you may find comfort in the gentle words, in the beautiful illustrations, and that through this book, you will find hope. My deepest wish is that you always know how truly beautiful you are, not despite your brokenness, but because of it. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and those who are crushed in spirit, he saves.
Wow, thank you for that, Terry. And then let me tell you and share with you, those who are listening, why Terry is doing that, because the theme today was in reference to crisis and how do we handle crisis in our everyday life. Not only that, we also are focusing on domestic violence. So with that being said, that's what that book is relating to, as well as we're going to have another guest possibly call in today, and her name is Kathy McKnight, and she is, runs a nonprofit organization that helps and serves women of domestic violence. So I just want to say to that is that hopefully she'll call in. She's scheduled to call in around 3. So if we get a chance to hear from Ms. Kathy, she'll tell us her story as well as she'll let us know how we can help the organization. And then we also have another young lady who may call in, and she is currently working with organizations that are helping women and serving that target population as well. So I'm going to turn it over to Terry so you can tell us the name of her as well. I know her name is Anna, but tell them about the mission of love and what she does.
Yeah, actually, Deborah and I visited Anna last week, mm-hmm. and her name is Anna Bueno, and she represents Mission of Love Charities, Inc., helping people, changing lives. And she's absolutely incredible.
Mm-hmm.
She believes this in this 100%, and she has, it's like a shelter, but they have clothes, they have people that will help you if you need help,
mm-hmm.
they have an area for prayer, and they have a food pantry. And supposedly there's only one of these in PG County.
That's right.
And she's looking for volunteers to help in any way possible. Right now, when we were there, I remember the whole side of the wall, there were bags of clothes that they want to donate to the homeless or to, you know, women of low income or who need help, and we need volunteers to help sort all of those items.
Mm-hmm.
So once again, it's Anna Bueno, and she's in Capitol Heights. Neither Deborah nor myself knew that it was even back It's incredible. They have a conference room. Hopefully they will be doing some training. They have training room areas too. We didn't get to see that. But there's something here locally and nobody knows about it. So we're here promoting it. And so
thank you for that, Terry. I just want to share because she did, Anna did give us a flyer. They're having a back to school community fair, and it's on August the 19th from 11 a.m. until 1. And so with the Mission of Love Outreach and Ministries, that's what they're doing. So they would like your help, you know, if you're able to and you have the money and the resources, or you can connect them to getting some materials and supplies for backpacks. Please, by all means, give them a call, and I will repeat the number for you as well. You can donate either backpacks, paper, pens, pencils, crowns, highlighters, calculators, folders, composition books, other types of books, crayons again, and rulers and staplers. Those are the things that they need. And they also need the little personal hygiene, because I know at my daughter's school, a number of them asked you to have the children have hand sanitizer and tissues and stuff like that. So you want to also be able to donate that as well if you're able to. And so the number or where you can donate at is you can bring them to the Mission of Love Warehouse, and that's 6180 Old Central Avenue, and that's Capitol Heights, Maryland, 20743. Again, that is 6180 Old Central Avenue, Capitol Heights, Maryland, and that's 20743. The number to contact them if you'd like to is 301-333-4440. Again, the number to contact is 301-333-4440. And so the reason why Terry and I are so passionate about it is that a lot of my background has been in domestic violence, working with women and helping women who have been victims of domestic violence. Terry has been doing the same thing as well. And so it's one of our passions that we're here to use this platform, meaning eLife Media, to get the word out how important it is to help those who, feel that they're struggling, don't know where to turn or who to go to, but also to let them know about some resources. And I believe we do have a call on the line, so let's find out who that is. Caller, are you there?
Okay, hold on 1 minute.
Hello. Hi, caller. This is Lady Deborah, and you're on eLife Media online radio station, and the show is entitled The Gospel Truth. Who may I be speaking to?
This is Kathy McKnight. Deborah, how are you?
Hi, Kathy. How are you? Perfect time. I'm glad you were able to call in. I know you're traveling. You're in the North Carolina area. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So you can hear us very well thus far?
Yes, I can.
Okay. Well, let me tell you who's around the table. You know, your good friend Terry is here, of course. Terry, you want to say hi to Kathy?
Of course. Hi, Kathy. I'm glad that you could get online.
Hey, Terry. Yeah, me too.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. And also, I have my co-host here, and this is Carlton Carter. I want to give you another little tidbit about Carlton. He is currently a candidate for County Council for District 8, and that covers the Fort Washington area, and that's okay. the Fort Washington, Oxon Hill, Temple Hills, Cass Springs, and Forest Heights, and I mentioned Temple Hills, but basically those areas. So, Carlton, you want to say hi to Ms. McKnight?
Nice to meet you, Ms. McKnight.
Okay.
Me too. You do as well. That's my area.
Okay. Well, that's your area. Great.
Yeah.
So what we'd like to hear, Kathy, is you to tell us a little bit about the organization and how you can take this opportunity to tell people a little bit about your story and how you got involved, and also give them an idea of how they can help the organization currently today, briefly. Thank you.
Okay. Bound for Better. I started in January 6, 2014, coming through the incident, the issues myself for about a year and a half, and working as a probation officer, I had the caseload of general and domestic violence. So you know, I never really thought that I would understand why a woman stays until you go through it. You know, so
absolutely.
And that's my story. I did. I had to hear, did you leave? I know where your kids live. I know where your grandchildren are. Everything. So I'm like, okay, no. I got to protect everybody. At this point, I felt as though I lived my life, you know, so just to protect everyone. So now I'm at that point where I can say, well, why did you leave? Why did you leave, man? Why didn't you leave? Now I know why. Because I didn't, in order, like I said, to protect everyone else. So then the last incident that really carried through, well, once before I was pushed out of, I had a car. And then I was taking this person home once in Charles County, and they was basically trying to tell me there was like a house that he was going to get dropped off and steal. He said, the house is back there. You know, just go back there. I said, no, I don't see a house back here. So I get in a car and I started driving back there, and it was like a field. And I'm steady going to the house, and then something just mid-stream just stopped me, stopped my brakes. I just slammed my brakes real hard. So I said, no, you have to go. You have to get out. You have to get out of my car. You have to get out of my car. So again, going through the whole things of hearing, I know we kids live and everything, and all this, you know. So I said, okay, let me just make sure I have this person around me in order to keep everybody protected, my parents and everyone. So I was going through some group sessions and counseling and everything, angry, upset, you know, felt as though the system wasn't doing any justice. As of this date, there is still an active fish warrant because it didn't show up. So, but there hasn't been any contact in over a year. I was making like every now and then a few block calls. Mm-hmm. But the last one was when, I can remember, Krista, 2 days after Christmas. And he was over to get the rest of the remaining of his things. And he stated to me that, well, you know, if I can't be with you, around you, then no one else will. I'm not going to let you treat anybody else the way you treated me. You know, so I'm trying to run down the steps and everything. At this point, he was getting ready to throw me down. So, and then as I got up, I just felt, like I said, this strength, Deborah, where it's like, okay, you have to go now. You have to go. And at this point, like I said, it really didn't matter then. Just go ahead and throw me down, because I was tired. I was tired.
You got to the point where you were sick and tired of being sick and tired, right?
Exactly. Exactly. You know, so when that happened, I felt that strength, and it was like my relationship is good with God. So it's like I felt just push me back. Like, I got this. Now in this time, because I prayed constantly all the time, you got to get me out of this, God. I got to get out of this. I didn't see no way, you know, because I procrastinated and starting this organization. One, I was at the sheriff's office, and mind you, I was doing warrants then. And like I said, I got a call, an issue with a young lady. She called before we were heading out. It was a domestic violence case. And she said that he's here, he's ready to do this to me, he's going to kill me, what he wants. You know, there's nothing I can do. We, you know, you guys not coming out. I said, man, we can't come out right now. So, again, you got a way of turning things around. So, I said, I wanted to start one. But, you know, procrastinated and stayed with school to move on to parole and probation. And not until it happened to me. So, that's when it was time. It's like, I need you to listen. So, that last incident right there was when I went on ahead and I said, no, this is it. I can't do it anymore. I can't do it. I can't protect everybody. I have to protect myself.
Yeah, so that's important. To protect yourself. But let me ask you this then, Kathy, because it's so important that, you know, women hear your story, because a number of times, just like you said, they stay in it for a multitude of reasons, you know, finances, so on and so forth, you know, and they don't feel like they have a way out. I understand that, because I've worked with women who they put a CPO or civil protection order out, and it goes on deaf's ear because he's still stalking them and harassing them. But what I would like for you to do, just so we can transition and we can give people an opportunity to call, is to tell them what you're currently doing now and how you are, you know, taking what you experienced and turned it around into helping those who may be in the same predicament that you were years ago. So tell us how you turned it around and how we can help you help others, and where your organization is and how they can get in contact with you and what you need for support.
Okay, I was determined to basically speak for the voices that I started hearing, the survivors that are here, and the one family members of the ones that's gone on. So like I said, I started mine in January, midstream of going through my own counseling. I didn't even finish my own, basically. So I got sent to the, that's how Bound for Baptist started. It started, and I partnered up with the Family Justice Center in Prince George's County. We've been open a year now, just July,
right.
This past July. So my organization do housing, temporary housing, hotel stay. I'm partnered up with two hotels. I do three hotel night stays. I'm working on grants, and we do a lot of these stays through fundraisers and stuff that we have.
Mm-hmm.
Toiletries, workshops. I provide food, working, trying to partner up with the training source so that they can, there are some women that come into the center to get, they want training as mm-hmm. far as a job training, because a lot of them are basically starting over now. So the ones that do, that just basically started with the housing, any type of housing material, toiletries or anything would help, because I have a lot of women that are starting, you know, they have to start all over with maybe one, two, or three children that they may have, and
right.
some are still in the shelter, you know. So like I said, mine is, I only offer three-night hotel stay.
Three-night hotel stays. That's good for everybody to know, mm-hmm. because that's a problem, because people say, well, get out. Well, where are you going to go?
Yeah.
Because
exactly.
what if your family doesn't know what you're going through, or you don't want
right.
to share that and let them know what
right.
you're going through, you know, through embarrassment, pride, whatever you want to call it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I've heard the stories many times before, and, you know, as women and stuff like that, we, you know, we feel a certain way emotionally about certain things, and some things
mm-hmm.
you want to share with the world, and some things, you know, you just want to keep hidden. But I'm saying, and this is my challenge to all the women who are listening around the table or in the world today who are listening to us, don't feel, as Terry mentioned in the book, broken and at despair. I want you to feel uplifted and know that there are resources out here like Kathy, like Anna, like Terry, and, you know, just have to connect yourself with some of them. So can you tell us, okay, exactly where they can reach you at?
Okay, I can give you my direct line. My number is
240-601-4517. 4517. Give them your name again, Kathy.
Kathy with the K.
Mm-hmm.
And it's McKnight, M-C-K.
Mm-hmm.
And my email address, my web address is www@bound.
Uh-huh.
And for, F-O-R.
F-O-R.
Better. Yes. Better@yahoo.com.
Well, you know what, Kathy, I want to share with you that this has been very informative, because I didn't expect you to go that in depth with your story, but I'm hoping that women who were able to hear your message, as well as where you turned it around and made it a positive, because there's a positive. There is light at the end of the tunnel, ladies. Okay,
yes,
and gentlemen,
yes,
because
is.
I want to
yeah.
say it's not gender bias. There are men who are suffering with this as well. So I definitely want to say that. But I think Carlton wanted to say something to you, Kathy.
Okay.
So go ahead, Carlton. I'm sorry.
Okay.
No. Have you reached out to any public elected officials for funding?
No, I haven't, Carlton. Denise McCain is our director up there, and we rarely get to know when grants are coming out, so I don't know. I do have the opportunity to work from home, so I'm back and forth, trying to, you know, get my organization to grant, and so I miss out on a lot of information as far as grants and everything. Like I said, everything will help, because I'm in the process now of safe haven, because, you know, we only have a family crisis center, but the one that I have now is a safe haven. It's secluded in Capitol Heights, so I'm just trying to get some stuff going on for that now. There's more to my story, Deborah. I'm all the way from the beginning of a sexual abuse. So,
well,
it's a lot. They can do it if they wanted to. They can get out. There is hope.
There is
hope. You just got to have that in you, you know, so as far as anything I can be helped out with, it would be helpful, because that was the last piece of information I got this last week, was that, okay, the house is ready to be open.
Yes.
It's just the funding. Yeah, it's just mm-hmm. the funding, because there are people, I'm going to have volunteers, a couple of volunteers at the center, they want to come and volunteer at the home. And my daughter, she's a social worker, so
mm-hmm.
she's willing to help out certain hours of the time, but these are ones that, some of the ones that we do want to have paid, like social workers and the mental health counselors to come in, you know, so stuff like that. Then you got to pay to have, keep the lights and stuff.
Yeah, the utilities and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Well, do you know of the organization we were speaking of, Mission of Love?
No, I don't.
Okay, so what Terry and I will do, we will connect you with Anna in reference to what she's able to do, but I definitely would like for you to come in whenever you can and actually put the face to the name and let the people also see you and do it that way as well. But I also want to give you an opportunity to personally meet Colton, because Colton, that's part of his platform as well. He's very passionate and concerned about domestic violence, and I'll let him speak on that.
Well, the other part I was going to add is the county just approved a budget for $500,000 for domestic violence. So, according to my understanding, in previous years it was averaging around $150,000. So they have pretty much recognized that this is a serious issue, and they have put more money towards the problem now. I would like to work with you to figure out how we can access that. Because where is the $500,000 going, and how can we get a piece of the pie? Are you a licensed 501c3?
Yes, I am.
Okay, wonderful. So we need to contact Mr. Obie Patterson and other councilmen who approve the budget. And I would like to work with you on that, and we will set up a meeting, and we will approach him, or since you are in District 8, we will approach him, and we will see what he has to say regarding of how to distribute those funds, because $500,000 was allotted for domestic violence this year, so I would like to know how that money is being spent.
Wow.
I hope that was some help to you, Kathy. And again, give us your contact information. I think Colton wrote it down. But the name of the organization and your contact number, again, just for those who are listening. For those who are listening, if you'd like to get in contact with Ms. Kathy McKnight, the number to get in contact with her, she will share that with you, as well as her email address. But if you want to call in, and then we can pass information on to you, the number is 240-455, and that's 5934. Once again, it's 240-455-5934. And go ahead, Kathy, give them your number once again, and we thank you so much for your call and your information, and we will see how we can support you. So your number?
Okay, it's 240-601-4517, and that's bound4@yahoo.com. And I will be more than happy to meet you guys and come on and talk more about it and tell everything. Thank you. You know, that's my healing part. I'm happy. That really made me feel, I'm happy to hear that, you know, because it's a struggle. It is hard out here. There's a lot of people that's working and trying to combat this crazy epidemic, but there's only one house. One house in Prince George's County, and they're always full.
They are always full.
Yeah. So it's hard. It is hard.
Any help. Okay, we will definitely tap into our resources, and I'm also connected in D.C. because there's the Coalition of Domestic Violence, and they do allocate money to various different organizations. It doesn't necessarily have to be D.C. located. If you're helping someone as it relates to domestic violence, that's what their goal is. So I will, you have my information, you have my email and my contact stuff. Just feel free to send me an email, send me a text or what have you. We can set up something. I can start talking to the people in D.C., see what funds are available, because a lot of it goes through the Department of Justice. I also want to say that they do funnel money that way as well. So I will let you know about the resources I have. We will definitely get you in contact with Anna, and so you'll have that as a resource. And then, again, we'll follow up with you as well as it relates to Colton as well. But thank you so much for calling in. We thank you for your time. And, again, we look forward to hearing more about you and what you're doing. And you have a great day. Thank you so much.
Thank you. You guys as well. Thank you so much.
Bye, Kathy.
All right. Bye-bye, Terry. Talk to you later.
Take care.
Wow, you know, it's just amazing to hear her spirit and just to hear how she's turned her life around and how she's willing to share that with other people. And it's just a blessing. So the least that we can do is connect her with the resources available and try to steer her on her way so she can get the monies for the funding of this facility that she's talking about and perhaps open even more, because one is not enough, I can tell you that, okay? Because we saw that when we went to that shelter the other day, that training center. It's just not enough. And so there's so much that people who are in those areas of helping people as it relates to domestic violence, they need your support, they need funding, they need, you know, your time. So whatever you can give, I challenge you today, whatever you can give to help those who need, that are the providers and the service providers trying to help and give back. Please, if you have anything to give that you can give, call eLife Media at 240-455-5934 and let us know how you want to help, and we'll steer you in the right direction. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and we'll be right back momentarily. Stay tuned. Thank you.
Where you at? Anywhere.
And you everywhere.
God has graced us all.
God has graced you. Gift.
Now where it went.
You everywhere.
This is it.
The gift in the sky.
I've been doing some thinking lately. And I know and believe that God still works miracles. Yet I'm so very, very grateful for what some call the simple things. I just want to take a moment here. This is my prayer. Listen.
I acknowledge that you're in control. And there's nothing too hard for you to handle. I believe you can do anything. Your word says so.
many more. Oh, today is a special day, one you never had before. I'll send you flowers by the hour, candy and perfume. I'm gonna shower you, precious baby, birthday baby, tonight. Oh, today is your birthday. I wish you many, many, many more. Oh, today is a special day, one you never had before. I'll send you flowers by the hour with candy. Baby, birthday baby, tonight.
Stop!
thanks for staying tuned, and welcome back to your host, Lady Deborah Radio Show. Also, I have around the table my co-host, Carlton Carter, as well as I have a guest host here. I have two, actually, because we just have the presence of Mr. Kendall Way. He just joined us, and he is going to be running for sheriff for Prince George's County. So welcome, Kendall. Yay!
Thank you for having me.
Okay. And also, who has been sitting around the table for most of the day has been our other guest host, and that is Terry Maxwell. Hey, Terry.
Hey.
All right. So what we're going to do at this point, we're going to go ahead and we're going to start with a biblical word. A prayer. And then from there, we'll go to the biblical word. So with the prayer, we're going to let you, since we know that you're an ordained minister as well, Kendall, we're going to let you go ahead and
Well, I'm a chaplain.
Okay. Correct me on that one.
Yeah, I want to be clear. You know, yes. People say, oh, he said he was ordained.
No, okay.
I'm a chaplain.
Okay.
But I would love to lead us in prayer.
Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
Spirit of the living God, we come before your throne to say thank you. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for every family represented this time. We ask a special prayer over the listeners today and over the issues that our listeners may be facing. Let the words that we share over this issue of dealing with crisis minister to the inner city of their soul so they may find solace in your word and know that there is a light at the end of the tunnel. And no matter what they may be battling, greater is he that is in them than he that is in the world. And though they may be hard-pressed on all sides, that they would get through this. And we pray this special prayer in the name of the one who changed my life, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Wow, for you to just come in and we just talked about, you know, it's right at the end of the tunnel. We had the same, little spiel earlier. We were talking to Ms. Kathy McKnight about her program and stuff. And we was like, you know, we're glad that she was able to share her story because we were like, hey, for the women who are listening today, there is light at the end of the tunnel. And so Kathy was a testimony for it. And then now you come. That's more confirmation. So thank you for that, brother. We appreciate that.
Thank you.
And so we're going to transition a little bit over here to no other than my future co-host, Carlton Carter. So, Carlton, go ahead and let us hear what you have to say for today.
So, I got to put out a shout out to Bishop Ken, wherever you are again.
Yes.
Bishop Ken. Where are you, Bishop Ken? You know, I always got to tease. We got to give Bishop Ken a donation. Yeah. I'll tell you, when a donation is a hand, maybe Bishop Ken comes back around. Bishop Ken, you're my boy. You know, I'm teasing you. But Bishop Ken always puts me into this position. Deborah emails me, y'all, on the 11th hour to try to pull something out of the fire to give you guys a word for today.
Yes.
I am not an ordained minister, nor am I a chaplain. So please have mercy on me as I try to impart with you a word for the day. So basically I would like to go from three scriptures, the book of Psalms 34:17-20. And it says, when the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of all of them. He keeps he keeps all his bones, not for one them that is broken. Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 12-9. But he who said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all more gladly of my weakness, and so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Philippians 4:19. And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Jesus Christ. So what I want to say to you is that everybody goes through crisis.
Yes.
Christ did not promise that because you are a Christian that you will be spared of not trials and tribulations. And so there are, to me, three seasons.
Mm-hmm.
You either are entering a storm,
right.
You're going through a storm, or you're coming out of a storm.
Mm-hmm.
And how you handle those storms is a test of your faith.
Yes.
And so you will get crushed. And the graveyard is the greatest sad point of all, because in that graveyard are all unfulfilled dreams that God has put in store for us because we've gone through crisis, and between going into the storm and getting in the storm, we never come out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And we're crushed by crisis.
Mm-hmm.
And so what one of my favorite verses are is faith without works is dead.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you are in crisis, you must push forward. You must persevere. And it press me about a scripture or actually a sermon that I heard about a poker player, and his name was Scott Blumenstein.
Okay.
Now, Scott Blumenstein won $10.1 million on a poker, as a poker championship.
I'm in the wrong field.
But he was struggling, and he stayed alive long enough till he got that one hand.
That one hand
gave him the royal flush that he needed. And then he came for almost being wiped out to winning. And so what I'm saying to you is that when you're going through your crisis, ladies and gentlemen, it's all about the struggle. It's all about holding on. It's all about persevering and keeping faith and pushing forward while you are going through your crisis, because you are going to go through your crisis. And so a personal testimony of mine is that 5 years ago I was wronged by an employer. And it's a situation that crushed me so bad it was even reported in the Washington Post. And so that part, and the people, in lieu of information, people started to fill in their own blanks.
That's right.
And so when they start filling in their own blanks, my opportunities for getting other things were also put in question, because all they could do is Google me and say, hey, what did this guy do?
Right.
And so I had to go through that darkness, and it was darkness because it was loss of income, I almost lost my home, I almost lost everything materially around me.
Right.
Because I could not explain to the another potential employer, why would a high performing employee be just all of a sudden let be wronged by their employer with no just cause? Because sometimes that just happens. And so when you have to go through that crisis, and just recently, when I was up for another promotion in another district, I asked that district to subpoena the other district to turn over my records to show that my innocence. The employer did not release my records to the other employer. I had to go get a lawyer to get the other records to be released so that I can go get the promotion. Because the reason why is because they realized they were wrong. They were wrong, and they were trying to cover it up. But yet that public opinion still stands out there. And so while you're going through your crisis, it reminds me, and I wonder why. You know, why I ask God, why are you doing this to me? Why did you do that to me? And I think I finally, after 5 years later, realized that it always will be a thorn on my side. So when I am to receive his blessing, I can't be corrupted.
No, you can't.
Because that thorn will always be poking in my side about the dark side and how politics can play. And how when you are doing the Lord's work, that your opposition will come, and there will be a crisis.
So I
love this Brother Wade here, and I'm going to tell Brother Wade that I like the way he thinks. And so when he does try the innovative things that he wants to do, be aware that they are gearing up for him.
Oh, yeah, they're gearing up.
And that all that smiles in his face is not necessarily going to be his friend in the end, because people are prospering off chaos, and so all the challenges that we hear that we have in Prince George's County, talking about a crisis, and you hear me talk about just in the last segment about the crisis of our school system and everything else that we have, some people are prospering off the crisis, and so they want the crisis to continue. Because it's profitable. But however, those who are going to stir the pot, let it be known that they are arming and they are ready to go. Now, your main thing is to make sure that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Yeah. And so you can't give them the weapon so that they can prosper. So you have to stay in his walk. You have to stay prayed up, and you have to understand that a storm is coming. And so crisis is in many forms, ladies and gentlemen, and all I can tell you is that faith without works is dead. Keep persevering, keep pressing on, because it's going to come, and it's going to come reciprocal. It's going to come. You're going to always, for me, I'm coming out of a storm, but as I'm running for office like Brother Wade here, guess what's going to happen now? I'm getting ready to enter back into the storm, and it's going to get rough.
But you're covered.
But I'm covered, but it's going to get rough.
Yeah.
And so crisis is just a part of life, ladies and gentlemen. And I just want to just keep let you know that the devil, the last thing I want to say is the devil plays tricks on you to let you think that you're the only one that's going through something.
Absolutely. I don't know that's
and that there are millions of people that are suffering from the same thing that you're being afflicted with. Mm-hmm. But he likes you to think that woe is me and I'm alone in this walk.
Mm.
And so I'm going to turn it back over to you, Deborah, mm-hmm. and then we will transition to Brother Wade.
Well, let me just say this to that, Colton, very profound, and thank you for that person there. Wasn't that great, everybody?
That
was great. You know what, and the thing that resonated with me with what you said, Colton, is because I've been through, because sometimes, you know, let me just say it this way. Sometimes people just don't like you just because. You may never have done anything to them. But, you know, when you're driving certain vehicles, I had a Jaguar, okay? And so when you're driving certain vehicles and stuff like that, and you have certain other things going on, and it looks on the premise that you got it going on. When you got it going on, everybody ain't happy for you going on, okay? Mm-hmm. So there, and then I call it in my book, I call them dream killers and blessing stealers, okay? Mm-hmm. Because you got some people that will try to destroy you and not let you mm-hmm. pursue your dreams mm-hmm. if you allow them to get in that space.
Absolutely.
So I tell you, everybody, don't let nobody stop you from your dreams, okay? Because through dreams, all things are possible, okay? You got to start with at least a vision, okay? And dream on. But you have so many people trying to come your left, right, back, forwards, and stuff like that, just trying to tear you down. Don't let them get in your way, okay? Because the enemy is busy, and misery loves company. So you have to be careful who you let in your circle. So, Brother Carl, I appreciate that, what you just said, because let me tell you, that's going to help a lot of people and reach a lot of people, because one of the things that happens with you all as you're running for these different positions and stuff like that, people want to be able to relate. You know, and they want to see that you're personable and you're approachable.
Yeah.
And so when you can tell something of yours, mm-hmm. oh my God, they'll buy into that because they feel like you connect to what they're going through and you're relatable. And I talked to Carlton about that as well as others, you know, as I, you know, study the field of psychology about it isn't just about what you say, but it's your body language as well, because more than your words is your body language that you present and you project on people that tells people a lot more about you. Whether you're compassionate about you, what you're saying, whether or not they can trust you, whether you're believable. So body language is key. And so that's one of the things that I tell the candidates that I help and work with about body language, not just necessarily the words. But I want to say what Colton just said today about crisis and stuff, he's right. And he, and as well as for you too, Kendall, because the minute y'all throw your hats in the ring and stuff like that, there's always going to be those people looking for stuff and trying to dig up this and that and other things to try to make you all look bad. But I say, you know, those of us who know you all and are around you, we know you're covered. We know y'all have faith. We know where y'all walk is, okay? So, as he said, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. So, I believe in that. So, with that being said, I'm going to turn it over to Terry and let Terry tell us a little bit about her book, since we're talking about domestic violence, be it verbal abuse or be it physical abuse, and why you wrote the book. And then we'll go over to Kendall and let Kendall talk about his platform, and I'll do his interview. So, can you briefly tell us, Terry, about, you know, your book and what you're doing?
Sure, absolutely. Well, last time I came here, I brought a business card because I thought that this was just a radio show. So this time, I brought bigger than a business card.
Yeah.
So it's more than my share of pain, 25 years in an abusive marriage, and how I got out. And what I say is just go to Google and put in Terry Maxwell, author, and you'll find blogs, and you'll see me on Amazon as the number one bestseller, and on and on. But anyway, I just want to say that I am a survivor, and I am so blessed, because when I was broken, it has helped me mm-hmm. make me what I am today. And what I am today is I help many, many, many women and men that have been with addiction, with alcohol and drugs, with sexual abuse, with verbal abuse, with domestic violence. And it's insidious. It is out there. At least one in four of everybody that I speak with encounters one of these aspects. Mm-hmm. And I wanted you guys to see about this. There's actually this thing called crisistrend.org, which I thought would be pretty cool for you guys to check it out. Actually, what they do is they've had 43 million texts, and they get together all the information that is about it. So if you go to crisistrends.org, mm-hmm. I put in Maryland sexual abuse, and what it shows is it gives a lot of different types of statistics. Wow. So people that have had sexual abuse also have 33% of them have depression.
Depression.
Right? Mm-hmm. There is also physical abuse. Mm-hmm. There is 24% stress. Mm-hmm. There's 29% suicidal thoughts.
Yeah.
And so that's just that trend. Then it's showing here that actually sexual abuse on this particular graph is going from, let's see what this first date is, from October 13th through July, that it has gone down drastically. So that's wonderful. So just check this out, because this is even good for counselors. If you have somebody that has had sexual abuse, this shows you exactly what other components are part of it. Because if you have an addiction or there's been verbal abuse, there are always two or three other things. If you're an addict, it's not just drugs, it's also alcohol or sexual mm-hmm. abuse or domestic violence. There's a whole lot of things going on in there. Mm-hmm. So this is a great website to check out. And my big thing is, what is your legacy? Why are you here on this earth? What are you here to do? Well, I can tell you, my belief about 12, 13 years ago was my son, I would continue taking care of my son. But I've been through a very difficult divorce, and I have been estranged from my son, which has been one of the most difficult things for me. So what I did is I decided I was going to write this book, and I wrote it in 3 months. My background is in management, having my own multi-million dollar business, and being in 100% commission sales. So my background is not writing. But this was a God call that said, hey, get this out and help some people. In 3 months, I got this book out on Amazon. Within 3 weeks, it was a number one bestseller. And from that, everywhere all over the United States, Trinidad, other places, mm-hmm. people are calling saying, help me, help me. Where can I get help? Where are their tools? Who can I talk to? There are tons of support groups that are out there. And some of the ones we mentioned today was Anna with Mission of Love Charities and Kathy McKnight for Bound for Better. We're on today. We're really out there to help you. So you're not by yourself. And I just want to thank Deborah for being on the same mission.
Yes, absolutely.
And Carlton and Wade for this. We're here to help. There's a lot of people that are broken. Mm-hmm. And you know what? I was broken too. It's the fight of your life, but when you get out, you're stronger, and that's when you pass on what you're here to do. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Terry, for
this.
Give Terry a hand.
Thank you, Terry.
Terry, can you share with our listeners how they can get in contact with you? If you have an upcoming event and the services that you are now having, that they can at least listen to, because I know sometimes people are doing webinars and stuff like that, TED Talks or what have you.
Right.
So share with them a forum where they can still follow you and hear what you have to say.
Absolutely. Well, I'll tell you, down the road will be TED Talks. So that is where I'm going to. But before then, you can go I have a blog. So it's author Terry Maxwell at WordPress.com.
Okay.
Or you can go to my email, which is www.authorterrymaxwell@gmail.com. I'm in the process of putting YouTube seminars together. I do coaching online. I do web seminars. Just reaching out to different people, different organizations, different charities, to be of service and to be a vessel. And I'm here to help others because of what I have been through. It was so horrible, and there was no one there for me until I found domestic violence center for 3 years, and I thought I was crazy.
and I was dying. And there are people that you can trust that are out there. And that was my biggest thing, was to get my trust back.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you're broken, you're normally a very depressed state, and you isolate, and things go down really quickly. So, however I can be of service.
Well, thank you for that, Terry. Thank you so much. As she said, there's a lot of people out here to help. For those of you who are suffering from the hands of domestic violence, be it verbally or physically, I want you to call in. Call in at 240-455-5934. Once again, the number to call in is 240-455-5934. This is very important to me. Not only have I had the work experience over a number of years, but as a psychologist in the makings, I also, you know, want to know, because there's some new things that are going on, because now we're working in my field in reference to digital storytelling, because nobody is always that forthcoming with having to sit there face to face like I am around the table with you all and want to share that, you know, abuse that has occurred. So sometimes now we're moving forward where I'm teaching digital storytelling, because if you don't want to sit around the table and talk to me, you can at least type it and then we can talk about it. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that's where we have gotten in the reference to the realm of therapy and letting people know that, hey, we know it's difficult. You know, that's not my experience, but we know it's difficult. And sometimes the trust factor, like Terry said, that's one of the first things to go. Because usually when you're in an abusive relationship, be it physical or be it verbal, the first thing that the perpetrator tries to do is they try to isolate you. So you lose your connections to your family. You know, and so, and then it's that paranoia of them with that behavior and stuff. Who you talking to? What you doing? Where you going? Why aren't you home? And all that kind of stuff. So I've witnessed this. I had one person on my case. She had gotten shot 3 times in the head. Thank you, Jesus. She survived. You know what I'm saying? I had a girl that had a Mai Tai cocktail, and I may be mispronouncing it, thrown through her window, you know, and it exploded and stuff, but she's alive. So I've been working with domestic violence for many, many years, okay? And it's near and dear to me, even though I didn't have the personal experience, but to hear the stories, I felt like, you know, I'm part of that as well. And so the goal here is to share resources today. We have these two candidates here. We have Kendall Wade, who is running for sheriff, and then we have candidate Carlton Carter, who is running for county council for District 8. And we want to give them an opportunity to share their platform as well as talk about what they plan to do as it relates to domestic violence. We're going to take a quick commercial break. We'll be back momentarily. You can call us at 240-455-5934. Again, the number to call in is 240-455-5934. If you'd like to listen to us live, you can tune in live at elifemedia.net. Stay tuned.
We just really want more of God. Now we don't want more of us, cause he did it. We giving them thanks even when they ain't awarding us. In them strip clubs, money, drugs, come on, cause you boring us. We've heard it all before, and I'm still unimpressed with that sort of stuff. We were made for more though, with them award shows. When you thank Christ, that lip service don't mean nothing if you ain't about that life.
Why are you owe me nothing? No.
And welcome back. Thanks for staying tuned to the Lady Deborah host for the radio show, the elifemedia.com and .net, I apologize. And you're listening to the show entitled The Gospel Truth. Around the table, I have no other than Terry Maxwell. And you just heard her little segment about her book. And also you have Carlton Carter, my featured co-host. And now joining us is no other than the candidate who is running for sheriff, and that is Kendall Wade. Welcome, Kendall. Welcome. And now
Thank
we
you.
Want to take an opportunity to hear a little bit more about you. And I want to just go ahead and take an opportunity to find out why is it so important for you to throw your hat in the ring as running for candidate for sheriff? Why is that?
Well, to be frank, I'm tired of Prince George's County coming in last. Mm-hmm. Our county has often been the least, the last, and the lost in many different realms. And the sheriff is a bridge that can bridge the gaps between so many issues in our community that affects the crime rate, mm-hmm. School system, the economic stability of our community. The sheriff is the one who can help foster the partnerships and relationships that we can bring together to lower crime. Mm-hmm. And so I've always been one not to sit around and just watch things take place without doing something about it. In fact, I consider myself to be a student of Dr. King. Oh. And Dr. King said, it's not the words of our enemies that we will remember, but it's the silence of our friends.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to be obedient to the master's call, mm-hmm. The vision he gave me.
Right.
And so with that being said, I will be the next sheriff of Prince George's County.
Yay, we're going to claim that darn thing.
Amen.
All right,
stand
all
on
right.
Those words. Yeah,
absolutely.
Thank you so much for that. And the other thing is that a lot of people want to know the crime has risen just, I think, a few weeks back. There was 4 murders here in Prince George's County,
yes.
And they were like within miles of each other, okay? And so what do you think is going on, and why is the crime rising? What do you think that is? How does that relate to what's going on?
Well, one of my platform issues, and let me be frank again, I'm not a politician.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not one of those who have a 3-step resolution to the issues in our community. If it could have been done in 3 steps, it would have been done a long time ago.
That's true.
So with that being said, I do have a vision that's going to help us get to a safer and better place. So to answer your question, I believe that education and jobs play a major role in our crime rate. Mm. Now, with that being said, we have a lot of people in our community who are sitting idle.
Mm-hmm.
And they also don't have access to certain resources because of, you know, job training, the lack of job training or the knowledge to ascertain a job and or keep it.
Mm-hmm.
So with that being said, I believe that, you know, once we're able to bring more jobs to this community, once mm-hmm. we're able to fix the school system and also be able to afford, you know, secondary training and things like that for, you know, trades, I believe that that will lower the crime rate. Now, in these instances in particular,
mm-hmm.
The one thing that a lot of these murders have in common, and there's been over a dozen in July alone,
yeah.
The common denominator has been handguns.
Mm.
So as the sheriff, I'm going to work very closely with the police department to get these illegal handguns off the street
mm-hmm.
and to restrict access for those who are not permitted to have firearms,
yes.
Either because of past felonies or because they're underage.
Mm-hmm.
But nonetheless, it's important for us to take a aggressive and progressive stance against illegal handguns in our community.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let me be very clear. I'm all for persons having the right to bear arms to protect themselves and their homes and things of that nature. However,
right.
we have to go about it the right way.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sick and tired of people saying, oh, I have this gun because I have to protect myself. No, everyone need to put these guns down and learn how to fight.
Mm-hmm.
Pick up those hands like we used to do years ago.
Yeah.
Because entirely too many people are being hurt, innocent people. People who are innocent bystanders are being hurt by these firearms. Mm-hmm. There was a rally that I spoke at in District Heights. A young man who was the shooter, he was 20 years old. Should not have had a firearm in the first place.
Wow.
So.
Mm. Okay, well, I just want to say that we have a caller on the line. So with that being said, let's go ahead and pick up the call. Okay, hi, caller, are you there? This is Lady Deborah, your host. And I have around the table my featured co-host, Carlton Carter. And a guest host here joining us today is Terry Maxwell. And also we have the candidate who's running for sheriff, and that is Kendall Way for Prince George's County. What's your question and how can we help you?
Hello, my name is Elizabeth, and I'm calling to ask a question to Kendall Wade. I've been following him on social media now for about a month and a half, and I noticed that his slogan, motto, hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Oh, okay, his motto is more service and less politics. Is it possible for him to, for you, Kendall, to elaborate more on that?
Thank you for your question. Elizabeth, correct?
Yes.
I appreciate that. Well, here's the thing. Our community has been bombarded with a bunch of empty promises from politicians. Our community is a place of great concern, but it's also a place of great promise. And so what we have to do in order to bring that promise out is put away all that bureaucracy and meet people at their needs. As Sister Maxwell said earlier, there are many resources out here for people who are suffering from domestic violence. Mm-hmm. However, a lot of people don't even know how many resources that are readily available in our community. Do you all know how many registered nonprofits we have in Prince George's County alone?
No.
Over 7,600.
Wow.
7,600 registered nonprofits. Mm-hmm. So what if there was a bridge? As your sheriff, a person who will come in, help bridge these resources, and also bridge the gaps when it comes to oversight, fiscal oversight for these nonprofits, who receive over $3 billion a year from both the state, the feds, and the local government. So with that being said, if without high schools, well, we have over 30 high schools in our community. Correct me if I'm wrong, Doc.
You're right.
So with that being said, 100 nonprofits can adopt a high school. Pour those resources into a high school so that these children will have more to look forward to than just a basketball or some rap music. And then what we'll be able to do is put them on a fast track to a better future rather than a fast track to the jailhouse.
Right.
So what I want to do as the sheriff, I'm going to come in and say, hey, if I could help with this. Now, people say, well, Kendall, that's out of your purview. No, it's not. See, that's the problem with our community. We are so quick to say, you know what, that's not my job, call this number.
Right.
So then that person called that number, Elizabeth, and that person said, well, that's not my job, call this number. And by that time, the person's frustrated. And they hung up and said, you know what, I'm going to handle it on my own. And that's the problem. So as the sheriff and with my forward thinking, I'm going to bring together the more service to bring the resources to people and meet them at their need, Elizabeth. And we're going to do away with the politics.
Well, does that answer your question, Ms. Elizabeth?
Thank you so much. That was a great answer. Thank you.
It was a great answer. Thank you for calling.
Thank you, Elizabeth. And make sure you tune into this show, okay? And tweet the show out so that everyone can know the great work they're doing down here.
I definitely will. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Very good answer. Now, I want to just sort of shift gears a little bit because I know that it's not going to be easy, Kendall, as Carter knows, you know, with his platform and getting the word out about his message. It's not going to be. So what do you think the biggest challenge you're going to face as you continue to pursue running for sheriff?
Well,
the barriers and all?
Well, here's the thing. I don't like to look at things as being a problem but yet an opportunity.
Okay.
Problems sometimes may seem bigger than what we are, and they may mask themselves as giants when in fact they aren't. And you know, people always say, you know, Kendall, you sound so much like a preacher. Here's the thing. Let me clear some things up.
Well, go ahead.
As Kendall Wade, you know, before you get you partake in any great undertaking, you have to know who you are and whose you are.
That's right.
Those are the things that will keep you grounded. And when all the advisors leave the room, all the news cameras are off, and you're left with your conscience and your morals, that's what you have to go to, your anchor.
Yes.
So Kendall Wade is anchored in my faith and my belief, which helps me make sound and wise decisions for the people in this community. So as the sheriff, it's simple. I am a young man, and I'm very proud to be a young man. Actually, today is my birthday.
Yes.
And thank you.
Happy birthday.
Thank
happy
you
birthday.
So much.
How old? Oh,
I'll share. I'm very proud of my age. I'm 29 years old.
Rocking.
Okay. So here's the thing. Let me tell you something. I'm 29 years old. Once elected, I'll be the youngest African-American sheriff in the 21st century in our country.
Woo!
And you know something? I'm at a prime age of leadership. I'm old enough to make wise and sound decisions and young enough to see them through.
And I think you're an old like soul, that, too.
I am. Go ahead.
I am. Okay. There's never been a major social undertaking in our a movement in our society that was not led by young people.
That's right. That's
the civil rights movement. Mm-hmm.
King and all of them were young.
Everyone young. Mm-hmm. Our beloved President Kennedy, the oldest mm-hmm. person, his administration was 44. Mm-hmm. Okay, the Attorney General was 35. And I want to be the sheriff at 30. I think that's okay.
Oh, nothing wrong with that at all. I'm impressed.
I'm going to shift gears a little bit because we have a caller on the line. So, caller, are you there?
I'm here. How y'all doing?
How you doing? Okay, you're speaking with Lady Deborah. And who am I speaking with?
This is Frank.
Frank, hi. What's your question?
It's really not a question. I'm actually watching you guys live, and I just wanted to say God bless you all on that panel. And I just want to say thank you all for what you do. It's really important. I'm extremely impressed, and I know that the show is really gearing up and really spreading the word. But what you all do is just amazing, and I want to thank each and every one of you. And I'm thank you for having the young man on who's wanted to share. I really do appreciate what he's saying there. I mean, he has a real old soul, by the way. But everything that you guys are saying on that panel and speaking out against, it takes folks like you all to really rev up the folks in our community. So thank you.
Well, thank you for calling, and we really appreciate your call. And we want you to stay listening to us moving forward, you know, at elifemedia.net. Okay, you will always get an opportunity to see myself and my featured co-host, Carlton Carter. We're here every Sunday from 2 to 4 p.m. And the show is entitled The Gospel Truth, and I'm your host, Lady Deborah. So we look forward to hearing you call in again and staying tuned. And again, thank you for raising your question or just letting us know that you feel this is a viable show and it's giving you good information. And that's what we're here to do. We're here to serve and give back. And that's what we're trying to do. So thank you once again for your call.
God bless you. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Amen.
All right. Well, Ken.
Well, Deborah, can I interrupt?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead. You are. Go ahead.
I would like, we do have another caller, but and I'll put my question on hold. But, Kendall, I want you to educate the audience. What is the difference between Sheriff, Prince George's County Police, and Maryland State Police? What do you do differently?
That's a good question. That's a good question. Don't call it.
So could you educate our public and educate me as well? What is the difference?
Thank you. That's a great question. So long story short, and I'm a big history buff, so I'm going to try not to be too long with this answer.
Okay, we have a call on the line.
Oh, fantastic. So the sheriff is the chief law enforcement officer of every county. Not the state's attorney. That's a common misconception. Mm-hmm. The state's attorney is the chief prosecutor. The sheriff is the chief law enforcement officer. That's why it's the sheriff's office, not sheriff's department. The head of the department is elected. Head of an office is appointed. Long story short, per the Constitution, every county in the United States has to have a sheriff's office.
That's true.
Not necessarily the police department. If you look at Charles County, they just have Charles County Sheriff's Office.
Exactly.
The sheriff's office is a state agency, mm-hmm. which means they have statewide jurisdiction and responsibility. But their immediate jurisdiction is the county that they serve in. So our immediate jurisdiction is Prince George's County and the 7th Judicial Circuit, which is Charles, St. Mary's, and Calvert. Mm-hmm. However, we have jurisdiction and responsibility across the entire state of Maryland as a state officer. And when it comes to municipalities in our community, that's 27 law enforcement agencies in Prince George's County. As a sheriff, I want to come in again, be that bridge to make sure that we all are operating on one accord and we're not shunning any agency because they may have two or three persons or maybe 500 people. We want to be able to be on one accord so that we can bring the best out of Prince George's County as we serve them.
Wow. Well, thank you. Good answer. Did I answer your question, Carter?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Well, thank you for that. Just to see someone, you know, with this youth and this motivation and just, I'm hoping for the young people, what would you tell them, Kendall, by you being, you know, as young as you are, to about, you know, because people are telling you, you're too young to run, okay, it's not your time, and this, that. Well, how would you inspire these youth who are listening to you on the phone and as well as out there when you're going out there in the public and speaking? How would you empower them and encourage them that age is not, you know, it's just a number, but there is a certain age where you can officially run. But at the same token, don't let it be the case that people are steering you away because you're not 40 plus. So what would you say to those
Absolutely.
People?
Absolutely. So you brought up two quick things. When it comes to persons who may believe people are too young to do certain things, mm-hmm. It may not be their time. Those people have to realize that one day someone was telling them the same
exactly.
thing with something in their life. And because of that time, they may have missed their season of opportunity. So what we have to do is, as a community, we have to work together. We have to heal the village. Now, as the sheriff, now I'm not coming in saying that I'm gonna have, you know, I'm gonna be the older person in my administration. No, right. You know, we have to work together with people across all age barriers, both sexes, every race. You know, no person in my county or in my administration will be treated differently because of any of that.
All right. Well, thank you for that. And we have a call in. Is that right? Okay, caller. Hi, how are you? You're listening to the Lady Deborah Radio Show, and I have my featured co-host around the table, Colton Carter, as well as we have two of our guest hosts here, and we have Kendall Way, who is running for sheriff for Prince George's County, and we also have Terry Maxwell, who is the author, and she also is working very heavily with those women who are suffering at the hands of domestic violence. So what's your question? And can you state your name?
My question is for Mr. Wade. I would like to know, if elected sheriff of PG County, what would he do differently from the current sheriff to decrease the crime rate that has taken place in Capitol Heights? There have been so many murders of young people, and I know it's black crime on black crime, but there has to be something that could be done about this. I mean, we didn't used to have this. This used to be in the District of Columbia, you know. So many murders, but now it seems like it's crossed the line in Capitol Heights. So what can he do to stop that?
Okay, thank you for calling in. And ma'am, your name, please?
My name is Michelle Owens.
Can you repeat that again? I'm sorry, we didn't catch that.
Owens, O-W-E-N-S.
Okay, Owens.
Yes, Ms. Owens, thank you for calling. Very good question, very valid question, and important question. So here's the thing. As I previously stated, we have got to get these guns off the street, and we have got to get these idle hands doing something positive and productive. Those are two things that when they meet, it is a horrible result. So as the sheriff, I'm going to have, again, different programs into place. And there's one program that we're going to be launching very soon. My team and I is going to be a gun buyback program.
Buyback. Okay,
well,
we're
going to, without asking questions, and with a partnership with the local law enforcement and other agencies, we're going to buy back firearms to get these firearms off the street. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, Ms. Owens, you know, we all have a responsibility to fix what's going on in our community. So I tell people all the time, we can't just address the issue of civil rights without addressing the necessity of civil responsibility. Amen?
Yeah, amen.
So with that being said, we have to encourage people, when you see something, you say something.
That's right.
Now, I'm not saying say something to the young boy out on the street corner, because he may not have the same upbringing as me. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
So with that being said, we have so many numbers in our community that people can call for tips. Information they can leave with law enforcement about anonymous tips that you can leave and say, hey, this house has this type of conduct going on. This person did this, and so on and so forth. Because in order for us to bring it together, we all have to work together. Now, here's the thing. Whatever the destiny is for Prince George's County, I believe we have a bright future. But whatever that future is, we're going to reach it together. Whether we sink or fall, but we're going to reach that together, so we have to work together now. So I implore you and everyone who's listening to work with local law enforcement. And does law enforcement have areas to that we need growth? Absolutely. And that's going to be something I'm going to bring as a sheriff as well. But when it comes to resolving crime, we need all the help we can get. We need help and prayers. Okay?
Yes.
I hope I answered your question.
Yes, you did. And I thank you so much. But I have one more question.
Okay.
You mentioned that there were lots of numbers out there, but I myself am a senior citizen. I only know 911, so it might be a good idea if you could get those numbers out, so that I would know those numbers and other people would know those numbers. You know, we don't always know what number to call unless they make an announcement on TV or something. Everybody's not. We're not savvy to all this new technician that they have out here.
Yeah, the computer.
So if you could just get it out there on the TV or the radio, just give us numbers that we can write down, and we'll have those numbers and we can make those calls. Because right now, you know, we are afraid to walk the street at night. So we could get those numbers, that would be great. And I thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you.
You all have a great day.
You too.
Thank you, Ms. Owens. Kendall.
Bye-bye.
And can I say one thing to the listeners? Mm-hmm. It's ironic she brought that up. Mm-hmm. My team and I actually developed a system to distribute that information.
Okay.
On the next break, I can go grab one and show it on the air.
I appreciate
And then what we'll do is we will make sure we transcribe that, all the listeners, to our website. Mm-hmm. Within 24 hours. You'll be able to have that information. We've been passing it out to the community, to those who we come in contact with, for that very reason. Mm-hmm. And I thank her for that.
Will you all be going out to the communities and or going to seniors organizations? Because, again, by me being in media, mm-hmm. they aren't as tech savvy, okay?
Absolutely.
They get their grandkids and maybe their children, their adult children, to help them with that. But that is a digital divide, if you will, when they are not as tech savvy. So I would like to see yourself, as well as Carter, those of you all reaching out to the seniors to help them, you know, be able to process and get access to the information that they need to protect themselves. Because it's valuable information, but if I'm not tech savvy, you know, I can't get that information. If it's not showing on TV, I can't, you know, I'm not going to know how to get it. So I think that Ms. Owens brought a valid point. I appreciate you and Carter trying to see what y'all can do to help the seniors with that. But also, I can't emphasize enough the importance of, you know, there's power in a message.
Absolutely.
And so the message that I'm hearing from you, as well as the message that I already know from Carter, is that, you know, crime is at a high. And you all both want to do something about that. And we appreciate that.
Absolutely.
So I'm very proud to have you both here today so we can enlighten people about what you all are doing, how important it is. Because as Carter said earlier, is that the crime, when there's high crime rate, it affects the housing industry.
Absolutely.
It affects where people don't want to come here, far as the school system. So it's not just, you know, a unilateral approach to it. It has many, many layers that causes Prince George's County to be one of those that's on the target, or the radar is one of those places people don't want to come to or live or raise their kids and have them go to school to. So we're going to take a quick commercial break and we will be back momentarily. So can you play some birthday music for us, Ron? Because it's okay. Well, don't play the birthday music. Okay, he's going to take us to commercial break and we'll be right back. Thank you all.
Now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things I can't see. It's my faith that moves mountains of doubt and uncertainty. I've got faith to believe, faith that's forever, faith to believe, faith that moves mountains, faith for my dreams, faith that's forever, faith to forever. I've
Okay. Thank you guys for staying tuned to the Lady Deborah Radio Show. Again, I have around the table here my featured co-host, no other than Dr. Carlton Carter. I also have my guest host here, Terry Maxwell, as well as we have candidate Kendall Way, who is running for sheriff for Prince George's County. You guys, this has been a very, very powerful segment. I want to thank you all for what we have done today. I think we've given a lot of information. And the only thing that I would like to say is that, Kendall, you wanted to share something with the listeners, and as well as those who are seeing this live stream. He has this card, but go ahead.
Turn.
Oh, mine is upside down.
Okay.
Why don't we all put them up so they can see it from whatever angle?
Amen.
Tell
Absolutely.
Them about this, Kendall.
Okay, so
one of them.
What you all are seeing right now, you all are seeing a refrigerated
yes.
magnet.
Yeah.
And this magnet has essential numbers in our county that persons may need, non-emergency numbers. Mm-hmm. Listed is the non-emergency number, a crisis hotline, the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, non-emergency numbers for sheriff, police, fire, animal control, numbers for the county government, county exec, county council, courthouse, school board, and certain services in our community, social services, bulk trash, the comptroller, WSSC, BG&E, Pepco, and Washington Gas.
Wow.
Okay.
So, if this don't get them going, I don't know what else could. But go ahead, Ken.
So this is something essential for persons to keep with them on their refrigerator, preferably. But this information, per our last call, I believe her name was Miss
Owens.
Miss Owens. Per our last call, I'm going to make sure that this is on our website within 24 hours, so persons can have this at their fingertips if they're not at home, and they need to go to our website. It'd be www.kendallwade.com, KendallWade.com. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for that, Kendall. You know, we're almost through with our segments. We have a few more minutes left, but I want to acknowledge that it is Kendall Way's birthday as well as mine. We're sharing a birthday together.
Absolutely.
So happy birthday to us both. At some point, Ron will play the happy birthday music.
So what you cooking, Deborah?
So I was going to get to that. There's a segment, Kendall, that you're not familiar with. I'm trembling trying to get it out. But it's called the What You Cooking segment.
Okay.
And that's where Carter here chimes in on me because I don't cook.
Okay.
So we talk about little cooking tips and all
so
of that kind of stuff.
Okay.
And he gets wound up because every time that he gets a chance to chime in about me not cooking,
okay.
he goes there. So today's topic in reference to the What You're Cooking segment, we're going to actually let Terry give a little bit about it because it's talking about the paleo diet. So tell him about exactly what the paleo diet is because a lot of people
yes.
have no clue what
Absolutely.
That is.
Absolutely. Well, the paleo diet, first off, no preservatives.
Yes.
Okay. No dairy, no legumes, no alcohol, but if you do have alcohol, you can have straight liquor or red wine.
Wait a minute, Terry, straight liquor.
Yes.
Go ahead.
And otherwise, you want to buy local, get organic vegetables, buy from your local farmers, grass-fed meat. So the most important one is no processed food. Try to drink half your body weight in water, in ounces. So if you're like 120 pounds, just do 60 ounces in water. And remember that your body only absorbs 4 ounces at a time. So paleo is wonderful for a lot of people that have health issues or want to lose weight. I had leaky gut syndrome about 2 years ago, and nobody could diagnose it. And I went to an integrative doctor who said, oh, you have leaky gut syndrome. And what was happening is my nose was running nonstop all day, all night, like a river. And so I got sleep deprivation. My mood was horrible. I mean, sleep deprivation is just bad enough. And so after having months of the doctors try this medication, try that, it's like you need to find out what is causing this, not cover it with a Band-Aid. So the paleo diet helped me tremendously, and it's wonderful. When you go into the grocery store, just be really careful what you bought. Read the labels. A lot of it is junk. Stay away from sugar. Stay away from sugar. If you need a little something sweet, honey or maple syrup, Does that help?
Yeah, that's okay. Pretty good. Cool. Thank you for that. Okay, so now we know a little bit more about the paleo diet, and I thought it was important when we do the cooking segment, because what we do, even though I'm not talking about me cooking personally, but we are definitely sharing information, giving out tips and stuff like that so we can remain healthy and eat healthy. So that's the purpose. And also, when it comes to Sunday dinners, the reason why I did this particular segment, Kendall, is because we have gotten away from the Sunday dinners, except for special holidays, you know. And I like to see that once we leave church, that we still get back to the table and we talk about, you know, things that's going on. And, you know, engage your kids, you know, so on and so forth. So that's why we called this segment the What You Cooking segment. Not like Carlton thought it was going to be about me trying to cook something. That was not on the That was never going to be the issue, but I just wanted to say that's where that came from. So anytime that we have a chance to get on that, he's going to go in.
I'm being very kind today because it's her birthday.
Right.
Kendall, you just don't know.
I'll be tuning next Sunday.
Yes. Next Sunday, I'm going to let it loose. let it roll because I've stocked up 2 weeks now. Right, Ron?
Right on.
So he'll give me a pass. So I appreciate that. Thank you, Brother Carlton. So the last segment we have is the mind, body, and soul. And I just want to tell you some of the things that we need to know in reference to crisis. And here we have some of the main sources of our personal crisis. There are many triggers that can cause and take us over the edge, okay, including stress and personal issues. Sudden drastic changes in your personal life, such as the death of a spouse, or a family member, marital separation or divorce, the loss of a job, incarceration, personal injury can also result in emotional overload. And so sometimes, just so we can, you know, get it talked about or spoke about, is that sometimes when we are going through our crisis, as Carlton mentioned, we may not have exactly how we want to handle it, how we want to deal with it. Do we want to share that with our family and our friends when we're going through these things? But I would say that when you're going through those battles or those trials and tribulations and stuff like that, work on yourself, okay? But also, I think that working on yourself is not the only answer. You do have to get some support. So I would encourage people to get support when you're going through, because we all have gone through it and we're going to go through, but your breakthrough is coming, okay? So just be cognizant that it's not the end of the world, you know, because we're all going to be going through something at some point in life, but it's how you get through it. And so, Kelly, you wanted to say something real quick?
Just really quick. You know, I always want people to be encouraged. I want every listener here to be encouraged. Because, you know, not only am I here to protect you, but I can't always be there. I'm going to try my best to be as your sheriff every waking moment. Mm-hmm. But when I can't be there, I want you all to know, especially the believers, that, you know, Genesis says that when God created us, he breathed his spirit into our nostrils, which means God is in us. So when you're going through, I want you to remind yourself that, you know, when hard times come your way and you need courage, you know, sometimes you say, please help me with courage, someone come and encourage me. But maybe courage is already in you. So maybe instead of God pouring courage into you, which you think you need, but it's already there, you just have to say, maybe he's just giving me opportunity to be courageous. Mm-hmm. Or maybe he's giving me an opportunity to be brave, or giving me an opportunity to be fearless, or to be a fighter. So I want everyone to be encouraged and to know that, you know, what you need is already in you.
Mm-hmm.
And you just have to bring that in. You have to bring that inside out.
Well, I thank you for that. And what I'm going to do now is I want to give everybody an opportunity to share with, you know, the listeners and those who are tuning in live. Hello. Where you're going to be, how they can get in contact with you, what your next event is, and, you know, just give them some insight on what's going on and what you have coming up. So, Terry, we're going to start with you.
Sure, absolutely. Well, I'm actually working on my second book, which is Walks with McDuff, and it's healing through living in the moment. So I'm really excited about that. My third book, actually, I'm getting ready for that. So I'm looking for people to interview on when you are going through crisis. What is it that helped you through it? What did you do? What tools did you learn? Were you given? That's going to be my third one. So I'm just looking for people that would like to be included in my book. And one thing I just want to pass on too is, you know, there's not really a good or bad. It's all about your perspective. So don't label things. It's all about your perspective. And even if you label it bad, it's still, you're going to grow from it. It's all part of the growing. So just love yourself, relate to a higher power, be the best person you can, see how you can be of service to those around you, and just find fun in your life. And here's to a great week. Thank you, Deborah Carlton.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, take care. I appreciate that. Thank you so much, Kendall. Your next coming event, and give them your contact information, and the same for Carter as well. He'll do that.
Absolutely. My contact information, my email is info@kendallwade.com. info@kendallwade.com. That's the best way to reach us. You may not necessarily see us at every parade, at every community event, but what we are out there providing services. We have programs for our seniors, programs for victims of domestic violence. We have programs on what to do when stopped by the police. So if you want to come out and be with us and you want to see us, you got to roll up your sleeves and meet us where the people are, because that's where we're going to be. So shoot us an email. Stay in touch. We'll shoot you all of our schedules for these classes. We'll come out and teach these classes, because that's what it is about. As your sheriff, I'm going to be out there where the people are and where the people need me. Thank you for having me. I appreciate all of you. Happy birthday again.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And now, last but not least, Carter, tell them about what you're doing and your upcoming events.
Two dates will be at Forest Heights Community Day. I'll be giving away free school supplies, and so please come out and meet me, and I will talk to you about my agenda and platform of how we're going to transform Prince George's County. And the second part is August 27th here, where I'm trying to work with Brother Wade here across the table. We'll see.
Amen.
And this will be a community day, and the community day will also be a where you come out, get something to eat, hot dogs, hamburgers, games for you, pony rides, hamster ball, and then we're going to have some other type of programs, domestic violence, voter registration, some sort of expungement fair. I even have companies that will hire people with criminal backgrounds on site. And so not only we don't necessarily have to wait to get into office to move something.
That's right.
And
that's
so
right.
And so awesome. So I that's why I want to make sure that whether I'm in office or not in office, we're gonna make this ball roll. But I'm just giving people a taste of what I can do out of office, and give and let them know what I can when I'm in office.
All right.
And so come on out. And those are the two dates, and I look forward to seeing you there.
All right. Well, let me go ahead and wrap this up, okay? I thank all of my guests here, Terry Maxwell, Kendall Way, and, of course, my featured co-host, Carlton Carter. And I thank you, too, my listeners and stuff like that. As I stated, it's Kendall and my birthday, so we're going to really blast the birthday music.
And happy 29th birthday to you, too, Deborah.
Okay. Yay! So I want to give a big tape to Kendall. Happy birthday. Thank you, guys. And we'll see you next week. Keep it tuned to the gospel truth. Thank you.
Oh,
bye-bye.
Wow. Oh, thank you. Oh, wow. Thank you.
This was great, man. Y'all did this.
I'm going to shout at you, precious baby, birthday baby. Oh, today is your birthday. I wish you many, many, many more. Oh, today is a special day.